Morning, it's 4:02, we're calling the Naples Joint Management Board. Sorry, we came to that, I'm standing there talking.
That's all right.
It'll be the first time I've been cut off.
I had more than probably one. At this time, I'd like to ask Commissioner Precinct 2, Lee Harvey, to call on his guest to be our invitation.
I asked Brother Bill Liggett from the First Baptist Church in Burt Burnett to come and give the invocation this morning, Brother Bill. Thank you.
Let's pray. Lord God, I come before your presence to thank you for this beautiful day. I thank you, God, for your provisions in our lives. Lord, we would pray for rain, just to begin. We honor you, we praise you, we thank you for what you provided for us, and we just petition you on behalf of our county and this region of the state. Father, I thank you for the judge and for these commissioners, and I ask your blessings upon their lives. I pray, Lord, that you would bless their homes. God, I pray that you would bless their lives, their businesses. Lord, I pray that you would keep them in your heart. Lord, I know that they struggle at times, and I know that there are difficulties that they face, Lord, that have nothing to do with being commissioners. Lord, I just ask, God, that you would bless them and that you would especially strengthen them in difficult times. Lord, I pray that you would bless them as their job here. God, I ask for wisdom and knowledge. I know that they face unreasonable individuals at times. I know that they have very difficult decisions that they have to make. And Lord, they serve us in the county. They bless us by their work. And God, I just ask that you would give them patience. I pray, God, you'd give them great discernment. Give them an understanding. And Lord, as they visit with those around them, I pray that you'd give them wise words. And Lord, you would give them kind words as well. Lord, I know that this is a difficult task, which they have. And God, I just ask that every day you would bless their lives, Lord, for their service to our county. God, we praise you in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother Bill.
Johnny, pledge allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Texas pledge, please.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you, Texas, please, please. I would ask the court to take action on the consent agenda.
Judge, having reviewed the consent agenda on Friday, I would make a motion that we pass it as presented.
Second. Motion by Commissioner Mahler, second by Commissioner Watts to approve the consent agenda as presented. Any comments or questions on it? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0.
Barry.
Attorney Michael. Okay.
Is the mute on?
It went back on.
Oh, okay.
Now it is.
Very good. I'll talk loud.
All right. Okay. Item number one on general business is to review and approve the emergency and regular bills for payment.
Judge, after reviewing the bills, I make a motion that we approve our emergency and regular bills for payment.
All right.
I'll second that, Judge.
Thank you, sir. Motion by Commissioner Gonzalez, second by Commissioner Mahler to approve the emergency and regular bills. Any comments or questions on any of the bills?
Judge, I set out on my desk a bill from the Extension Service for car rental at the end of September. And I just wanted to clarify, I was under the assumption that the agent had already transferred jobs, and I didn't know where some of those expenses, if they were to us or not, so I'd set those out.
Okay. Yeah, because her effective change was October 1st to Young County.
Well, and if that's the case, this is a September, end of September bill. I didn't know if it was, I thought she had left in September.
No, sir. It was kind of, she had one foot in one county and one in the other.
Okay.
She is tall.
Okay. Well, and then secondly, there was some jail medical, Devin. I set aside, I just wanted you to look at those line items so we could see. We're trying to determine the outside of medical coverage, medical expense, and so I set a couple of those out just to show you. But.
Okay.
Do we pay them or do we not?
Yes, everything can be paid.
Okay. You're just asking for clarification.
Yes, clarification on them.
Okay. Any other comments or questions on the bills? Okay. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you. Item number two is to receive a presentation from Mr. Quincy Quinlan, Director of Health and Benefits Services at Texas Association of Counties on health insurance and benefit options. Mr. Quinlan, glad to have you all here.
Thank you. Is it okay if we sit?
Yes, sir. Judge?
Please
thank
do.
You
so much.
Yeah. You might want to tilt that microphone a little towards you there then. Thank you.
Yeah. Quincy, you can, if you stand up, you can pull that
thank
lever.
You.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he's out of jail.
Quincy has the distinct position of being the first person that ever told me we had a Cadillac medical plan, and I've never forgot that. I'd just come out of the hospital, and I think my part of the bill was quite a bit, and I thought, man, if this is Cadillac plan, well, somebody's in trouble. But anyway, I'll never forget that, Quincy.
All right. Yours, sir.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having us. Court, you should know that the judge kept insisting that we needed to come and visit, and so we said, as you know,
well,
the judge...
that warrant helped, didn't it?
Yes, the judge is a persistent okay. man, and so here we are. Also wanted to thank Wichita County for your continued participation in the pool. I believe that it has been beneficial to the county. I was just running some numbers last week, and we figured up that in terms of the surplus distributions over the past since 2008, you've gotten back close to $750,000 in the surplus distribution. So we think it's been a good deal for Wichita County. It's certainly been a good deal for us at the pool. And so we're thankful for your long participation in the pool. The judge reached out to us and said, you know, you send us a renewal and that's fine, but we're concerned about the dependent coverage. Is there any way we can make this a little bit more affordable for the dependents? Obviously, the county is paying for the employees. What can we do for the dependents? And so each of you should have a handout in front of you titled 2016 Alternate Plan Proposal.
She's going to take one over to Linda Castillo. I think you've met Linda. Linda is kind of in charge. She has her.
Yes.
Yeah, Corey, this okay.
Yes. And seeing Linda reminds me that we also should thank you all for helping us straighten out the issues with the eligibility and billing, and that's working wonderfully. Thank you very much for that.
Well, we appreciate your reconsidering it costing us $25,000 less than where we were. So yeah. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so the handout has five columns. The column to the left is the current plan that you're on that ends on December 31st of 2015. And then the second column is renewal rates for tier. That's the renewal that you agreed to, that if we don't do anything today or before the 31st, will start January 1st of 2016. And then in response to the judge's questions and concerns, the third column is renewal rates 5-tier. And what we've done there is, in an attempt to honor the judge's request to look at costs for dependents, we've added an employee plus one child tier, which you currently do not have. So that you would have employee plus one child as one tier, employee plus children as another tier, employee plus spouse, and employee plus family. And we walk through the numbers. And then to the right of that, option one is a five-tier plan that includes employee plus one child, but it also makes all the changes that we can make and still leave your plan grandfathered. This is 2015. You'll recall that definition of a grandfather plan is one that was in existence in 2010. And what the Affordable Care Act said is you could only make so many changes before you lose your grandfather status. Why does the grandfather status matter? Because as you will see from the very last option, which is titled Option 2, if we change and went to a non-grandfathered plan, even though the deductibles are higher and the coinsurance limits are higher, the costs still go up from the other options that we presented to you. Why is that? Because when you lose your grandfathered status, your costs actually go up by about 2% or thereabouts, because you now have to cover all preventive services at 100%. No deductibles, no co-pays, no co-insurance. Anything that's preventable, 100%. All women's preventive health services, 100%. And so the costs, in fact, do go up when you lose your grandfathered status. So like most of our counties, you've decided to remain grandfathered, and we suggest that to most counties, unless they absolutely have to look at the non-grandfathered.
And Quincy, what on that topic, why is there such a law that governs the grandfatherability of insurance? What would be the purpose behind that? To say, change three things, you're grandfathered, change four things, you're not.
They recognize that lots of people had rich benefits, and for those who did not want to whittle those down too much, they were saying you can keep them. But they also recognize on the other end that rich benefits drive cost up. And so they were trying to do a balance between people who already had rich plans, leave them where they are, that's fine. But the other thing that they were thinking about is folks looking at cost might want to go and make dramatic changes. And that's why they said, no, we don't want to. And I know it sounds conflicting. The statute is, after all, a massive compromise. And so on the one hand, they're recognizing that people have benefits and this drives up cost. On the other hand, they recognize that some employers might be inclined to cut those benefits dramatically. And they wanted to say, you know, if we'll leave an incentive for you to provide rich benefits if you want to.
So the number three or four might just be an arbitrary number that they chose, but the real incentive is to hold down changes.
Yes.
And we don't know if that's three changes. That they had to pick a number to set that. That would be my interpretation.
They did indeed. And yeah. So they have the list.
And may not be anything significant between three and four, but they've got to put that line somewhere, and that's yes. where they drew the line.
They passed a rule and said, here are the policy things that we right. think this is why it matters. Okay, so that's the broad strokes. Let's go through the numbers so we can explain what we've proposed for you. If you did nothing, then on January 1 of 2016, your employee-only rate would be 763.48, which is a 4.85% increase. That compares with a 5.8% overall increase for the entire pool, and so that although your costs did increase, they were below the increase that the pool as a whole received. We thought that your 36-month loss ratio looked very good. And people sometimes ask, why is it if the loss ratio looks good or costs go up? As you know, healthcare is unlike anything else in the economy. You notice oil and gas prices went down, gasoline went down, inflation's not going anywhere. In fact, as a result, Social Security recipients are not getting an increase, and yet healthcare goes up. It behaves like nothing else in the economy. And as you all are fully aware, Wichita Falls is one of the most expensive places in the nation to get health care.
Why is that, Quincy?
There is some interesting hospital billing that happens in Wichita Falls. But the federal government has recognized that it's one of the most expensive places in the nation.
Is that because of our health care provider, our hospital?
Yes, sir.
In Wichita?
Yes. It is. Your bills are high compared to other regions of the state.
But what I've wondered in that, you know, we have these, and I sit on that advisory board, and they have not changed those rates now generally in 5 years. There was unquestionably United Regional Healthcare was at the top of the list the year they went to the increased billing. They've stayed. Now there's others have joined them at that level. But Medicaid and Medicare pay, they don't care what this is. they're going to pay this. Doesn't Blue Cross somewhat structure that the same way, that they're only going to pay so much to for a service to rendered by a hospital or a doctor or not?
They don't quite have the negotiating clout that Medicare does.
Gee, what an understatement. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, obviously Blue Cross's network is the best in the state, but even in Wichita Falls, they struggle with the price. I mean, you know, healthcare is such that if you're the only provider, the only two providers, you choose one of the two, people have to have the coverage, they have to have the service. And so it's sort of, they know they have you.
Okay.
And so it is a challenge for the Blue Cross networking people to keep doing this. And you know, it's a challenge. Just this summer, we faced in another county a hospital asking for 40% increase in their billing rates. It is a tough market. And hospitals believe that, you know, they have you over a barrel.
Well, Judge, it brings in the question for me, our 8% mandatory indigent health care, it sounds like it would not go as far in Wichita County as it would go in other counties in the state of Texas.
No, because you only pay Medicaid rates. Your rates are capped no matter what the hospital charge is. And
it's based on that.
And part of our arrangement with the hospital, because we in the city of Wichita Falls, the ultimate,
we set that all up.
There was an agreement, if you have an inmate out of Wichita County Jail in the hospital, we pay for doctor services and we pay for emergency room service if they're taken there and then admitted, but we do not pay a daily hospital cost. That's part of our agreement with them. And then our amount of money paid to the hospital is also capped at up to 50% of, Willie, help me here, I think I'm that agreement was 20-something years ago, but it's capped at 50% for hospital costs of the indigent amount of money of the 8%. So we do have some safeguards in working with the hospital. Then what that does, that adds to their uncompensated care costs. So whether it's that or it's when we reach with the indigent program, and there is a significant amount of their, as probably in any hospital, but I know it, compensated care.
And doesn't that drive the pricing?
Well,
Judge, I mean, you would assume.
It does, because if you're not getting paid here, you've got to charge over here. You know, I always look at, I'm just amazed to see a tie someplace at $35, and I wonder how much of that cost of that tie is because somebody shoplifted two others, damage, you know, things that happen. There are costs that are added into most merchandise that are social costs.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So,
you know, the other strange thing that it's always been kind of an interesting phenomenon to me is the city and the county own the hospital. We don't operate it.
But
we have, yeah, thank goodness, we have Blue Cross. You don't want the jail and the hospital. Yeah. So you, judge. You know, we've got Blue Cross Blue Shield for our employees, and the emergency room doctors at our own hospital don't even accept it.
And that's
been a challenge for
that
us.
That is common across the state.
Yeah.
They know you have to have them, and so
yeah. You can go in and negotiate some discounts. But the first time I ever used it, I didn't realize that you had the option to go in and negotiate the cost down. And if you don't do that, it hits you pretty hard, and that's tough on our employees.
Yes, it is.
Well, the other thing about this that just jumps right out at me is, now what do you talk about our increase,
4.85%?
Well, there goes our 4% cost of living raise, doesn't it, on January 1st. Wow. Back to even.
Or
actually less than even, I think. But still, I mean, that's the reality that we're operating under right now. And I don't, you know, Quincy, you watch this thing all the time. I don't see that changing, that trend. I mean, do you?
It is challenging. Well, I will say this, and this may sound like a pipe dream, and I apologize. I should have introduced Brian Nizer, one of our financial consultants, and the one who actually put this these options together for you, and he'll chime in. But it's one of the frustrating things about healthcare. And you were making the comment about the uncompensated care judge. That's why you're seeing all the debate between Texas and the feds about 1115 waiver, because it's clear that this uncompensated care is driving a lot of small hospitals out of business. We recognize that their pricing might be a little skewed, but they have real costs, and that uncompensated care is a huge challenge in Texas. I think last year, a group of the largest counties in Texas sent the Texas Senate a letter saying that the tab was somewhere like $4 billion of care that they had given for which they had gotten no payment.
So. And you know, I fully want everybody to understand my comment about the 4-point-whatever-it-is increase. While I say that, on the other hand, I don't want last year's technology. I don't want technology from 10 years ago. I want today's technology. So that costs money, those improvements.
But just to be clear on that increase, that if an employee of this county, which only covers themselves, did not receive a 4% increase, they have now received over 8% increase from the county.
Absolutely.
Because that cost is consumed by us.
Absolutely.
And Commissioner, it doesn't make it any better, but I think one of the things that I would also highlight is the cost of care. Medical trend is going to increase at 7.6% next year. That's the cost of health care will go up 7.6% next year. The renewal at 4.85 is not recovering all the costs that we expect. But the reason why we can set it at 4.85 is because of your claims experience has been favorable. We see medical just separating out around 5%, and pharmacy trend is around 12%. So we see pharmacy trend increasing at a higher rate than we'd like to see, and everybody's seeing that across the board. Your blended rate is 7.6. It doesn't make that 4.85 any better, but we're doing what we can with the programs we have in place and changes that we're making to help keep that increase to our counties below medical trend.
And your point's well taken, Commissioner. I was referring to somebody that's picking up a spouse or a family. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Wow. The last thing I'll say on this general macro topic is, I was going to say, it sounds like a pipe dream, but what my actual goal is, long-term, looking 3, 5, 10 years down the road, is to see if we can actually bend the cost curve. And this is the last thing I'll say about this, because we have real numbers to go look at. But if we can affect the utilization, how much your folks go to the doctor, which in fact depends on how well or how sick they are, if we can affect that, we can change the cost curve. And there are instances across the country. There's a county in Florida that we're looking at that over a 4-year period, their premiums and their claims went down. And so that's my long-term goal. If we could shift this model to a model of health, where we say to folks, if you can do this and get healthy, your claims go down, and when your claims go down, your premiums go down. Because all of this entire exercise that we're talking about here today is driven by the fact that we have an actual estimate for what your claims are going to be in 2016, and we have to collect enough money to cover those claims. My favorite saying is, somebody's got to pay for the claims. So that's the long-term goal, and we'll talk more about that as we roll out some more programs to actively affect the health of your employees in a positive way, so that the claims can go down. And then hopefully we'll get some meaningful relief. All right, if you don't mind, let's go back to the handout. So if you look at the renewal that you've accepted, that's the second column, renewal rates 14, and you see the employee only at 763.48, no employee and one child rate, employee and children at 1251.50, employee and spouse at 1603, employee and family at 2027. The only comment I'll make about your renewal, apart from the 4.85%, is the fact that spouses are our most expensive tier. And we looked at your numbers, and the employee and spouse, the average age of the spouse is 59. In your employee and family, the average age of the spouse is 49. All other things being equal, 59-year-olds are a lot more expensive than 49-year-olds. And so across the pool, and it's no different here in Wichita County, spouses are expensive. But the real driver for the judge was the dependents, and so we said, how about column three, renewal rates with a 5-tier? So we said, let's add one child, an employee in one child tier, and see what that does. Our actuary, we are fortunate, also does the actuarial work for ERS, the state plan, and also for teachers' retirement system and University of Texas. So he can look at close to 1 million lives in Texas, the same hospital, same doctor, same everything that you all use. And so we have a very good idea of what cost is in Texas. We don't have to worry about what it is nationally. We know what it is in Texas for government plans. And one child costs somewhere around $190 a month. And so that's how we derived the 95348. We can tell with accuracy that you're an employee plus child. At a $500 deductible plan would cost about $190. And so that's how we got to the 953.
So the 953 number, if it's employee and one child, the employee would pick up $190 additional dollars.
Correct.
That just to make sure I'm on the same. Correct. Same thing on down the way. In other words, you take the 1204, subtract the 763.
Correct.
That county's going to do. Okay,
correct.
I got you.
So is the same true then, Quincy, for a spouse? When we deduct that initial county payment out of the spousal plan, that across Texas is the true amount for what spouses cost to treat, which would in fact be considerably more than what it would treat us as employees.
That's what I'm saying. Spouses are that expensive. And the fact that your spouse is an average age older means when we do these rates, we're also taking into account your experience. So we're looking at the entire pool experience, but because you have so many employees, I think we're coming 393, somewhere around there, plus dependents, we also take into account your actual claims experience. So we're looking not only just across the state, but we're also factoring in. So these are what we call blended rates. So the children, we don't use blended rates. We know across the state because children are usually such low utilizers of care that we can just take the number across the state. But for the spouses, we will blend in your actual experience. Your actual experience.
So that's not a across the state.
No, that's across the state bill. Blended with your claims experience.
It's curious to me why a spouse would be more expensive than an employee.
When you look at the industry and the industry standard when setting rates for an employee plus spouse tier, it's about 2.5 times the employee only rate.
Wow.
So to point out, right now at your current rate, you're at 2.1 times. So you're underfunding your employee and spouse tier rate, which leads to some of the numbers you're seeing when we went and reset the 5-tier rates. We tried to push you more to where we would set them if we were rating you as a brand new group, sitting down with our underwriters and our actuaries, and going with the guideline of employee and spouse tier is 2.5 times the EO rate, employee only rate.
Well, so that I'm clear, we utilize the spousal coverage that we have at the courthouse today to determine what that rate's going to be over and above what we pay as far employees of this courthouse. So if we have 300 and some odd participants, maybe 100 of those cover their spouses, we use that 100 to determine what this amount's going to be.
We use the actual claims of the 100 to determine it. So we look over the 36-month period and say, what do spouses cost us? And factor that into the rate.
But if you're just dealing with 100, Jeff, you could have two or three bad deals and it would really skew the...
Yes, you could. And that's why I say it's blended. If we use your actual experience, you would get what you actually deserve. And we don't do that for any group. We have what we call...
Those smaller numbers are not, they don't help you.
But right. We have what we call a pooling point, and claims above a number we take out and don't even consider. That's the value of the pool to you. We can absorb losses that you couldn't.
Right.
But Quincy, why isn't it figured if 350 are employees and there's 100 spouses, why aren't there 450 utilized to cover that cost?
Whether we spread it across your entire group as opposed to just the spouses?
Yes.
Yes, we don't use a loss ratio for the spouse. I'm just saying we know what the spouses cost because we look at it. But I'm saying the actual rate that we derive is blended. So yes, you're correct. It's covering all 583 or 590 that we cover.
We did that 1 year.
Yes.
And I think it was done by the pool. Everybody looked at and hit those in those groups. I don't think everybody lived through that. Now, and I say this somewhat joking, but if we actually are, if you are really putting that experience to us, then we ought to tell you when we get rid of an expensive spouse.
Oh, we know.
Okay.
Oh, I'm clear about
it. Let's make sure we all understand. Let's say they're no longer covered.
Right? Okay. Oh, just this morning, Brian was saying to me, oh, yes, that person's going off the plan at the end of the month. We know. We follow that.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you get credit. You don't know what the replacement is going to be either. Yeah. That's not.
Yes. But you do get credit when those events happen.
But what we do want to do when we're setting the tiers is we want to kind of follow, you know, the guidelines that you need to follow, your underwriting guidelines that you need to follow, because you want dependents on the program. You don't want to structure your tiers so that you're driving off your dependent, your children. If they cost $190 a month, really, you want them on the plan. And you need to be able to set the rates so that you're covering the contributions to cover the other costs that you are incurring, which is in the spouse tiers, which are, in this case, older than what you would normally see as well. I mean, our average age in the pool as a whole is 48. So when we're talking 49 for the average age for the spouse in the employee family tier, or 59, you're that much higher in that, and we need to account for it.
The point that Brian is making is it doesn't matter how we structure the rates. At the end of the day, we still have to get to the amount of premium that covers the expected claims. Because no matter what we do in the tiers, the claims, we're expecting the claims to be the same.
Yep.
Does that make sense? Based on your historic projections.
Well, I've always said insurance, you're either paying ahead or paying back, because the goal is the premium should balance against the claims.
Yes.
And yeah, so we're doing it. But what I'm
looking at, when we, let's say we looked at option one,
that's going to cost, the reason that option one costs less is because we're changing the deductibles. I just glanced at that down. Is that?
Yes, yes. What option one does is it makes all the changes that you can make to a plan and remain grandfathered. It changes all the copays, all the deductibles, all the coinsurance. It does everything you can up to the edge and still remain grandfathered. So if you took option one, you couldn't change these factors anymore. That would be it. The next thing would be to go to a loss of grandfathered status. And to make the point, if you move to option two, you can see that the deductibles are even higher than option one,
mm-hmm.
but the cost went up.
Yeah.
And the reason for that is the loss of grandfather status. You now have to do all those preventive services at no charge, and so your cost will go up.
Judge, just to be specific on option one, the benefits that would change is there'd be a $100 increase in deductible, a $500 increase in the coinsurance maximum, $5 increase on the office visit copay and the specialist copay. The generic copay stays the same. Brand goes up $5 and non-preferred goes up $5. So those benefit changes or that cost shift is what brings the price down that you see in the contributions.
Okay.
If you go to option one and go with even the increased copays, good grief, that's what, $24 a month. That's dang near five visits difference in the copay deal. I mean, that, to me, that looks, I don't know.
But why would you want to change if the first three plans are what you have proposed to begin with? I mean, there is coverage for children on there with a slight increase over the other, but leaving the plan intact as it stands today with no change in the ability to cover children.
Well, we can't renew for that, though. can we?
Well, that's what's the proposed renewal for 2016, correct?
It's in, yeah, the renewal rates, but what I was looking at, I asked them, could we do something to change what our employees are paying for dependent coverage? And what that does in option one, if you look at that, you've got an employee with one child is $30 a month savings.
Yes, that is correct. But at the same time, all of the employees, their increased deductibles go up just to cover a handful of children that may or may not participate in this program. And to change the entire base of the all employees to allow for a kid to save $30 on insurance.
Got to look at participation numbers. And what I'm hearing is the numbers aren't there. You're right. You're going to be out of pocket is going to overwhelm the savings.
If you're using it, but.
Well, that's a good point.
No, but you're not with small children, and with one of the other things that we're going to add, we all approved it last week, is the option through Colonial for you can pay $9 a month or $16 a month, $9 for employee only, $16 a month, and you have the ability to call in, talk to a doctor, get a prescription based on what you tell for you or for your spouse or your child. And now it's going to cost you under this, it would cost you $5 more for a generic or $10 more for the other two categories on that prescription. But you don't pay any copay to go into the doctor. It also gives you the side thing of a service similar to LifeLock is included in that. And so it does this offset, and it depends all on usage. And either way, we're kind of crystal balling. And I don't know, Linda, can you recall offhand how many are in each of these categories?
It's not a great number because of the cost of it. So what I set out was, what's the goal
to lower that premium? And the only way you lower that premium, something else has to give in that.
Judge, I think we have the tier numbers here. Employee only, 373. Employee plus children, 37. Employee plus spouse, 19. Employee plus family, 20.
Employee only, okay, 363?
373. Quincy, run down that again, please.
Sure.
Yeah.
Employee only, 373.
Okay.
Employee plus children, 37. Employee plus spouse, 19.
92?
19.
Okay.
And employee plus family, 20.
Okay, because that adds up to only
449.
How much?
449.
Yeah.
We probably have another 20 or 30 in the waiting period that are because of the termination, the turnover. There's 60-day waiting period. So
there's. Well, if you've got an add to 48, 49, and pull in the trash, you're not going to have what?
No.
But they're not there.
But what that would make, it's I don't know if for those numbers, that we're talking about, that's 56, 76 dependents in that. But I was just trying to figure,
sure.
You all asked
that. I asked Quincy and me and Brian have responded. With them. Now, the other thing that you look at, and I looked at it and need to revise that number, but if you take, I was using 500 employees because that's kind of what we consider our number to normally be, but you've got vacancies in jail and some other places. But if you base that on 500, the premium savings to the county is going to be $140,000.
And given some of, you know, some of our other costs, that's a consideration. But, and the goal was to try to, for that, those with dependent coverage, was to make that a lesser number for them. But, you know, it's hard to say how significant that would be without having the exact experience factor of those to look at.
I kind of agree with Commissioner Watts, though, with no more numbers than you're talking about to bring that savings, and you raise everybody's copay. You're at least you're all.
Did the copay go up only on drugs? Didn't it?
Well, your primary care
visit too. $5 on.
Which, okay. Which, so it went from 25 to 30.
Which? Okay. Which one?
Option one.
As opposed to the renewal rates 5-2.
Yeah. Right.
So you've raised the I'm saying copay, that may not be the right term, by $5 on
office
on 373 people to save a little bit for what, 37 or 20 or what was the number, 50 or 60?
Well, you had 73.
I guess I don't know. You'd have to study that, see if that's a good deal to run the numbers on that. We need a spreadsheet.
Quincy, we had talked about changing the deductible from 500 to 1,000, and you have only illustrated moving it from 500 to 600.
Right, option two to 750.
Neither one of those are 1,000. I was wondering what a $1,000 deductible would do to the monthly premiums.
Well, it's 1,000 out of network, but it's not.
No, it's a. We're talking about
$1,000. I apologize for that, Commissioner Harvey. Judge Gotham spent most of the time with Bill Norwood, and he's out last week, and so I didn't get the $1,000 option. Otherwise, I would have brought it.
Judge had talked about possibly moving our deductible to $1,000.
Right.
And instead of passing that on to the employee, only in the instances where an employee did meet their deductible, we would subsidize that,
right,
and try to lower those monthly premiums as correct much as we could for our people.
I apologize. I will send that back. As soon as I get back to the office, we'll send great that back.
But there was a caveat in that, and I'm thinking that came from y'all, but I'm not sure. If we did that, then we get into a bunch of HIPAA coverage, because then we would be having the medical records and we'd be reimbursing that employee based on that, and it put us into a whole different category of reporting. Does that sound right?
Yes. Somebody in your office would be seeing claims if you yes were to do it. Another way to do it is if you could set up an HRA on HSA and have that administered so that the payments are made only as reimbursement. That's one way to do it. Or you can do it prospectively as a health savings account. So there are different ways to do it. But yes, most counties who are doing this kind of program have somebody who gets HIPAA certified. It's not that difficult. And then you set up your firewalls and everything so that only that person can see the claims. But yes, you'll get more involved with claims if you do that.
But to be clear, you're talking about a $1,000 deductible.
In
you would reimburse anyone that incurred more than the $500 they had yes to make. So the employee,
that was the mentality,
employee doesn't see a difference in the deductible.
Correct.
The county.
And we're betting that a whole lot less people actually need the insurance. So we've got it, but we were thinking that maybe, you know, we came out way ahead because, you know, a lot of folks wouldn't.
Yeah, I apologize for that. As soon as we get back, we'll send that to you.
Yeah, we can work that up pretty quickly.
Would we not see a substantial savings in monthly premiums?
Typically, when you go that high deductible, you will see a decent savings.
Yeah.
Well, let's work up the numbers and send them to you.
You're getting 24 now for $100. So if I know you can't extrapolate that out because it's not a direct deal, but if you maybe you'd get $100 savings for
Would it be more? You probably lose your grandfathered status.
By moving the deductible only?
Yes. Any one of those changes beyond
so
the
many changes.
Yes. Loses your grandfather status.
Right.
So it's not that you have to do five before you lose it. Any one change beyond the limit that they set, you lose.
So what you're saying is that deductible cap may have a limit to it below the $1,000. And then if we lose that grandfather status, then we go over here to option two.
it is complicated.
The maximum amount you can change your deductible without losing your grandfather status is $600. So when you move it to 1,000, you're going to lose grandfather status, which means that some of the savings that you achieved in that $1,000, 2% of it
is offset by the increased cost.
Well, can you provide us with those numbers so we can make an informed decision?
Yes.
Well, are you thinking you would supplement that deductible straight across the board, or by reason, or I mean,
I would say straight across the board. If somebody had to have medical care and they met their $500 deductible, we would assume the next $500 would, right. You know, on an average,
yeah.
Judge was explaining that he thought that maybe we would come out far ahead by much lower premiums for our people, and yeah, cost
but,
us also.
But I want to be clear on much lower premiums is, in my book, cut half in two. To save $25 or $30 on a premium is
correct.
Not a lot of savings
correct.
In my mind.
We just need those numbers so that we can make an informed decision.
Yes.
Yeah, because we don't know if it's $100 or if it's $150 or $300. We don't know that, and we need to know that.
Yeah. I apologize. We'll get that to you this week.
Okay, and I may have kind of held that off based on what I was concerned about if we were going into having to add a second person and do this, the HIPAA compliance, that we were headed in the wrong direction.
We can certainly support that because there's a number of ways you can administer it, as Quincy mentioned. And you know, an employee can bring in their explanation of benefits that show they've satisfied their deductible and
there you
or
go.
Show where they're at in their deductible, and you just use that to reimburse the employee however you decide to do it. And we can produce reports
if that change takes us out of our grandfather status, I think it's moot point anyway.
Yeah, I do too. And you're going to have to hire a whole new person to help organize or keep straight all of the benefits that come down that pike and the exceptions to it.
You might have to say what you just said again. He didn't hear you.
Yeah, I think it's relatively an easy administration. Yes, there has to be someone at the county that's going to reimburse the employees.
And track it and keep up with it, correct?
And track it. We can provide a report from an audit trail perspective. The employee can bring an EOB and you can use that.
Correct.
And we can provide a report behind that to audit against it. So that can be administered in that fashion. I will tell you that there's counties that do that today. So the question is, I think, is how much savings do you get in that premium adjustment with that $1,000 deductible? And I would also add that we can run a report along when we send you the $1,000 rates for the rates for a $1,000 deductible. We can also send you a report to show you what your deductible accumulation looked like in this past year. How many employees hit the $500
sure.
level? That give you some sense for what you're going to be
absolutely.
Looking at.
Absolutely. I'd love to have that information.
And I think we'll be surprised to see that, again, it's a small number of people that incur a large amount of
the cost.
Mm-hmm. And so you're going to probably see, because we see this on a regular basis, I don't think Wichita County is going to be different, you're going to have a small handful of people that ever hit that $500 deductible.
But the ones that do.
So that I understand, if I go to an out-of-network provider and I incur some doctor visits, like at Kell West here in Wichita Falls, they are not Blue Cross Blue Shield, nor do they accept them. And I have to pay $200, $300, $500. How do you track those costs for me?
We are not talking about out-of-network. We're talking about network deductible.
That's
We're
correct.
Talking about when you go to a network facility today, you have a $500 deductible.
Right, but what about that cost? How do I, in this equation, make good on that money I spent out of network?
You'll get an explanation of benefits once that claim's in process to show where you stand in your deductible. You satisfied $250 towards your $500, or you've satisfied your $500 deductible and now the plan's reimbursing. So,
But you're asking, does it count towards the deductible?
Does it count towards the deductible, and who determines that? Do we determine that, or do you determine that?
No, that's Blue Cross claims adjudication. Blue Cross will process, they determine that, and they apply it. There's no change to the way it's done today.
But I have to submit it to Blue Cross in order to have that happen.
You would have to submit it to someone at the county for that reimbursement if we're talking about reimbursing over the $500.
No. Once you submit it to Blue Cross and Blue Shield, it automatically would be reported to the county.
Yes, but I'm just thinking about my last incident, and I go to Kell West, none of covered by Blue Cross Blue Shield. I wasn't there for very long, but incurred nearly $2,000 of expenses
Didn't submit it to Blue Cross?
It's not submitted to Blue Cross Blue Shield, and I'm not taking advantage of it today because I've done met my deductible for one, so I didn't need it to do that, but there are those instances.
Yes. And how do you get that into the
records? That's right.
What you're asking.
And the answer is, based on the way your plan is structured, the answer is no. That's out of your pocket in time.
Non-network.
Can you also, when we looked at this tier one option, the option one, give us the numbers, in other words, in that group of 76 people, what has been their history? In other words, would we be saving them if they averaged, three doctor's visits a year? In other words, are they really going to save anything if we change that up and they were saving $30 or more a month on the premium, but they're then by the $5 increase on the office visit cost and the drugs, are we really going to save them any money?
We can run a report that'll show the average office visits per participant, so we know they're going 2, 3, 4 times a year, and then you can do that analysis from that number.
And maybe their number of prescriptions. In other words, are we saving them any money, or are we actually we're going to go the other direction?
Will depend on the individual experience.
Yeah, Judge. I agree, but at least we got something better than the empty crystal ball.
I think the sad thing about this is incredibly expensive for the county,
everybody,
and the individuals, and everything we look at here today really doesn't bring a lot of significant savings.
No.
I mean, there's some savings. I'm not picking on you.
We
looking at that, but it really doesn't get us where we would really like to be.
Say for on county premiums that we're paying $100,000.
That is significant.
Okay.
Roughly around $150,000.
Yeah.
And this is going to continue to be a challenge for years to come, I would assume.
Yes. And it's just Friday I was reading another story that said, for the money that America spends on healthcare, it outcomes 19th in the developed world. We spend the most money and we don't get the greatest bang for the buck. And that's why I made the comment earlier about the need to reorient ourselves away from doctors to being well.
That's the one thing I picked up from this conversation, the thing that just rang true, is we need to be healthier.
We need to be healthy.
We really do. That's going to be vitally important. It's going to be more important as time goes on. It looks it up.
We need to do away with
Brad State.
And no more. And do away with TV remotes. You got to walk over there.
No, we laughed, but we had a doctor from Blue Cross at our Healthy County Conference in February. He said, "Sitting is the new smoking."
Yeah. Yeah.
That they're beginning to associate very high costs with the fact that as a nation we sit and don't move.
But I tell you, the age end of this deal has a lot to do with it too. I guarantee you, I've had more health care in the last year than I've had the rest of my life.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how quick it.
Well, when we first started the Healthy County program, one of the commissioners had been very healthy up until that day.
What are you saying?
This was one before you, but you served with him. But he was like, "Dang, I don't want to know anymore."
And he participated too. That's what was.
But he's still alive and he's doing well. But yeah,
he started taking 3 medications after that visit.
Got to be careful what you ask for.
Yeah. So. Well, then we won't take any action today, wait, get the other information from you.
Good.
And what we might do to be respectful of you all and your time is maybe do get that and do a work session on a Monday afternoon by phone with you all, and then that way we could kind of go over it, because even though you're going to send it, we want to excuse me, be sure we correctly understand it.
Sure.
As much as we like to see you guys.
Yeah. But at any rate, so I'm glad you all got showered this morning before the water main broke out there.
Thank you for coming today.
Thank you so much. And again, we apologize we didn't get quite all
well, and I have some ownership in you getting that, because when I saw the other, I just didn't have the understanding that Brian was saying this might be more obtainable. The other thing, let us know who some of the counties are that are doing that.
Absolutely.
We may want to make an inquiry, find out, is this just a bump in the process, or is this a mountain to do it?
Sure.
I bet there's some data there, Judge, if we could.
Well, my question is that an absorbable thing?
Yeah.
Is it, you know,
and what's the administration?
Right? Yeah.
You know, that's the question.
When I first got it, when you had to become HIPAA compliant, I immediately thought, no, that's beyond what we are envisioning. We aren't saving. We're going the other way. So,
yeah. Well, and again, honestly, there are benefits to being non-grandfathered to the employee. I mean, when you're talking about making that move, now you're covering preventive services at 100%. So whereas today you're paying a $25 office visit copay, it's now covered at 100%.
Yeah,
so
the county's paying for it.
The county is paying for it. It's an offset, but employers are seeing something. You have to factor that into it. When we're looking at the utilization, you have to factor that piece into it as well. So we can get you the statistics on that utilization so that you can look at whether it offsets the savings or not. And I think, you know, what you'll see is you're going to see low utilization, only a couple of visits a year to the doctor, mostly generic, 80% generic, so there's no impact on there in the increased cost, because 80% of your population is going to stay at the $10 copay and not that preferred brand. But we can run those numbers, and we can actually, since we already did this, we can churn that out pretty quickly for you at this point. We just didn't know to bring that, and we apologize, as Missy said, for that.
The other thing, the last time you were here, which was several months ago, we talked about the doom and gloom of 2018 coming.
Yes.
You all were going to work on options, because that affects the whole pool.
Yes.
How is that coming along?
The IRS in the last month published a second paper that said, here are things that we're thinking about as we set about the task of writing a rule to implement this tax. Long way to say, we have no idea what they're going to do. And until they tell us, the first question is, what dollars are covered by the tax? You've heard, when you go over the threshold, it's a 40% tax, correct?
Mm-hmm.
What goes into the amount that gets you to the threshold? They have not decided. And so it's that uncertainty that prevents us from saying to you all, here's what we're going to do. We just don't know. We're in a wait-and-see mode, like everybody else, trying to figure out, because it matters greatly, are they going to include FSA funds? Are they going to include COBRA funds? What are they including in that number to get to the threshold? Because if it's more than just your premium, we have a completely different conversation. And so that's a long way of saying we're watching it very closely. We've got folks in Washington watching it and trying our best to, as soon as we know something, to roll out a program for you all. We're making some educated guesses about which way they're going to go, but so far we can't roll anything out to you because we just don't have a definitive
answer. Okay.
And that number, even though you don't know what you're counting towards that number is $10,200 for employee only. That's $850 a month. So you can kind of see where you're at right now at $763. If you stayed at a 5% medical trend over the next 3 years, you'd hit it in 2019. You wouldn't have it in the first year, but you would start hitting it in the second year. I mean, in the second year, 2019. But again, it all depends on final regs and what it's actually counting towards.
I will say that, and this is no great hope, but the groups of people who are coming together to oppose this are significant. The Republicans and the trade unions are banding together to try and get this stuff. They say politics makes strange bedfellows.
Interesting combination.
Yeah, it's a very interesting combination. And we're hearing whispers that the IRS doesn't like it either. And they wished it would go away, but it's in the statute. So you have some Democrats calling for its repeal as well. But they estimate up through 2029 it's going to take in $430 billion. And the price tag for the statute is $1.3 trillion. You get rid of the tax, we're going to get some billion to fund at least a part of the statute. So those are all the issues that are in play with that.
Okay. We don't know what option that Cadillac's got on it yet.
We do not know.
Okay. Well, Quincy, thank you all. Brian, thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Judge. Thank you, Commissioners.
Yeah. Thank you.
Quincy, y'all are welcome to stay. I know you want to visit anything after, but if you all need to, if you want to get headed back to,
thank you,
to Austin, that's either way. It works for y'all.
Thank you.
We're pretty entertaining, but dried paint challenges us sometimes. Okay. Item number three, we had on the agenda last week and took off, is discuss, consider, take action to amend court order 1503157 dated March 16th, 2015 to include an extra cost of $310 for the DVM 800 vehicle camera for Constable 1 for a total cost of $4,200 plus installation to be paid by transfer from general fund contingency to the appropriate line as determined by the county auditor. I talked with Matt Davila and with Judge Little on that. Judge Little's here. We originally paid that out of your technology fund, I believe.
Yeah.
And
sorry, I was so depressed after that last
time. Okay.
Slow getting out of the chair there.
Well, you know, you qualify for that most expensive group.
Yeah.
I would ask one question. I'm not sure, and I didn't try to change that and ask you that. I got it back on here, but the additional funding should come out of your technology fund.
That's correct.
Okay. And then I talked with Matt this morning about that, and he just said he did not check the item that came in. He had it, a bunch of other things. They were all doing it, that installation, put them together. And when I talked to
Jim Malone in the auditor's office, he said for some reason the former clerk for that ordered the camera that was like the ones in the sheriff's office, but it was not the one that the order approved. The company has agreed to accept that back. We want to do that because there's a $500 rebate tied to the DVM 800
that we would. Also, there's extra 3-year warranty.
Yes.
It's a 5-year versus a 2-year.
And that, and the operational ability of the camera to do front and rear. So if you have a juvenile passenger in the rear, you've got that covered. The other thing is, if we get to the new Justice Center with the new bookend area and the wireless technology, this will be compatible with it. So to me, it sounds like those things. What I'd ask the court to do is to allow in this order to modify it, pay it from the JP's technology fund, and to include the uninstalling of the current device and installation of the new device in that order. You all may have some other questions, Judge Little or me, at this time.
I would make that motion that we do that, Judge.
Second.
Do we have a number on that installation?
No, sir, we don't. The gentleman that would give them that this morning had a funeral and was not available.
You want to do an up to or just leave it?
Just leave it that,
okay.
Yeah. They've always been very fair. We already know what the charge was for. Actually, it ought to be a repeat probably of what they took out before. They right. put it back in. It could even be less. You know, some of the cabling were the same, but it should not exceed what we previously paid for that. Any other comments or questions on the item? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0. Item number 4 is discuss, consider, and take action to authorize the IT department to purchase a new IT-built computer from Bass Computers for the new employee position in the court administrator's office at a cost not to exceed $1,100 to be paid by transfer from general fund contingency to a new extended budget line set up by the county auditor. Ms. Cully?
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Judge.
This item was actually added by the court administrator's office. She asked for the price, but she actually placed the item on the agenda.
Okay. Are there, the only thing I had wondered on that, you know, we were taking some desktops out of the DA's office because of the new laptops. Were any of those available?
Or? No, sir. Those have all been allocated for County Clerk Eagle.
Right. Okay. Okay, that was the other thought I had on that. I was just hoping the numbers weren't the same, but okay.
Especially, aren't you building these computers?
Yes, sir.
You do that, so you just get the basic components and then you assemble them, which saves us quite a bit of money, right?
Anywhere from $600 to $900, depending on the machine, is what I saved by putting them together.
Okay, so this would be, as it says, well, it'll be IT built, or is this going to be open?
No, it would be, I'll build it also.
Okay, all right. That's what I thought. It did say that. I glanced at mm-hmm. more.
Is this what it's costing us actually to do all those that you build? I mean, is this
yes,
just the, you know, what I was thinking?
Roughly, it varies depending on if I have to build one that's a little bit more beefier, or they don't want dual screens, or there's a little bit of variation, but not very much.
And is that with operating system on it?
Yes, sir.
Could I ask court to make a motion?
I so moved, Jen.
Second.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Mahler, second by Commissioner Watts to approve the item as stated. All in favor, signify by say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0. Item 5, discuss, consider, take action to authorize IT department to purchase parts from Bass Computers for 5 IT-built computers for the Sheriff's Office and County Judge's Secretary in an amount not to exceed $5,000 to be paid from 100.412.3152 office equipment. Ms. Cully?
These are 4 computers for SO Patrol and 1 for Joyce. This is on the 5-year rotation. These were purchased in 2008 and don't have any upgradable parts in them. This will be the last set to be upgraded for this year.
It's a budgeted item, isn't it?
Yes.
I'd make a motion, Judge.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Mahler, second by Commissioner Watts to approve the item as stated. Any other comments or questions?
Thank you.
Thank you. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 5-0. Item number 6, discuss, consider, take action to approve a quote from Goodyear Commercial Tire in the amount of $3,337 for furnishing and installing 4 17.5/25/12-ply Titan loader tires for Precinct 1 with payment from 221.220.3610 tires by transfer from other 221 supply lines as needed to cure the deficit. Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes, we had to replace the tires. We had one that was cut pretty bad, and we put a tube in it and didn't think it was going to hold, and the other ones were pretty well worn, so we decided it'd be best to go ahead and replace all 4, and we kept 2 of the ones that were could make good spares.
Okay.
So I make this as a motion.
I'll second that, Judge.
Thanks, sir. Thank you. Motion by Commissioner Gonzalez, second by Commissioner Mahler to approve the item as stated. Any other comments or questions?
Judge.
Yes, sir.
The line is actually, it's just a typo, it's 221.210.3610.
221.210.
210, yes, sir.
All right, thank you. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carried 5-0. We're down to public comments. Anyone in the audience wish to bring anything up? I thought you were moving. Commissioners?
Judge, I'd like to mention that early voting, according to Lori, starts today, mm-hmm. and the times and places of those are listed on our website.
They were also in the newspaper, that coverage. And it's the normal early voting sites. This building, the Psych Center, and Home Depot, the Precinct 4 building in Electra, and where in Burke? I'll say number.
Precinct 2 Barn.
Precinct 2 Barn, okay.
Judge, we had a very nice celebration for Sealed Air this last week over in Iowa Park. The chairman of the board, as a matter of fact, his CEO was there from France, and that's been a tremendous asset to Iowa Park. And I tell you, they really put on a nice celebration.
Oh, absolutely.
Had all of their employees there other than a few volunteers that were running the plant that day. And they've been a great partner for not just Iowa Park, but Wichita County, and certainly good neighbors. We enjoyed the hospitality. It's a great celebration, and they're looking forward to being there a while, and that's good.
Sounds great.
Sorry, I missed that.
Yeah, it was good. It was a good get-together.
He mentioned to us over $40 million invested in the last, what was the time frame? New equipment, $33 million in Iowa Park, $7 in Wichita Falls.
I think in the last 12 months, matter of fact, or maybe 24 months, but they're doing well. And when James Frank asked you the CEO what we could do to help him, he said raise more cattle.
Eat more beef.
Eat more beef. That's a good one, too. So I like that.
Okay.
Judge, we need to encourage folks to go vote. There's some things on the ballot that need some attention. And, Mary, there's one on the Homestead Act that raises that. There's the County Assistance District, which is about $1.4 million of tax dollars. And if we vote for that, we can get those dollars home. A lot of people are not going to take the time to vote because it's not an election year for, you know, candidates and stuff. But it's still a very, very important time. We do need to go vote, and there's some things that need your attention.
On that note, Lee, Tommy, how does that work on school district taxation that's out today in the mail? And
Commissioner, we went ahead on our statements. It all went out Friday. That $123 reduction is already in place. That's why they're calling it a provisional tax statement. You know, we're all betting money for the first time in a long time. The state of Texas taxpayers have a chance to offer themselves some relief. So what will happen if it doesn't, I'm thinking it affects 16,789 homestead exemptions in Wichita County. But for some reason, if it doesn't pass, we'll have to turn around and do a second billing just to those 16,789. So it's not like another 74,000 accounts that have to be addressed. But I would probably say, if I was a betting man, that citizens of Wichita County will vote in favor of that, about $123 savings.
Now, for the ISDs that are outside your purview, are they doing the same thing?
They have to do the same thing. Okay. Yes, sir.
You had to go one way or the other, so you go with where you think it's going to wind up.
The problem was, Commissioner, was that under the Texas tax code, we have to have our statements in the mail in October.
Right.
But you got a November election, so that's where the quandary's been in all this deal. All 254 tax assessors in the state of Texas were caught in the same situation. But like I said, I really feel like it's going to pass. I just can't see it not. But stranger things have happened.
If you give this group that additional 10,000, then you shift that, let's say that 16,000.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that caused an increase in all non-homestead exemption
properties,
taxes, didn't it?
Properties, I would assume.
There's probably, as we know, Judge, in politics and life in general, there is no free lunch.
Okay.
You know,
but if
it's going to show up in the laundry somewhere else, I can probably assure you.
Well, it is, but what I'm saying is, let's say if that, okay, I'm going to guess that all of those other non-homestead properties are paying more. If it didn't pass, would you have to go back and adjust them back down?
We'll capture it next year.
Well, then
your certified roll, your certified roll's out. I mean the horse is already out of the barn as far as his tax year.
Okay, the certified, the value is the same, but the tax. Clay shaking his head no. Then are they paying more with the exemption?
No.
Somebody's got to be making that
no,
up.
They made it up, Judge, in their tax rate at the ISD.
That funding is being supplemented by the
state
out of the state budget this year.
Right.
Where you need to watch what's going to happen next year.
Okay. Yeah, the state's going to send them a check to offset that, was what I understood.
That's exactly right. They will take it out of their rainy day fund, from what I'm told, through what I've been reading legislatively. They're going to fund this year out of that rainy day fund to send that additional money to the school districts.
And then they'll have to capture
okay.
it next year.
Okay.
We don't know.
I heard you
say that on the floor.
I thought, man, that's going to be interesting. So that is the way they finally.
You're thinking along the lines of what happened to us with the 100% VA disability exemption, where those VA 100% VA homes were completely exempt. That shifted that tax burden over to everybody else. That did happen and continues to happen. But with this, it was handled differently because it was a school district funding mechanism that's controlling that.
Okay. Well, that when they
we
first
won't know for sure until probably April of next year. That's when we start seeing the first signs of legislation that is in the meetings. You know, in the meeting groups. And that discussion is going on. That's when we'll first start to see which way they're going next. But we don't know.
Yeah, because when that first 100% disabled vet homestead exemption got put through, that actually in Wichita County was better than $100,000 in revenue and nothing offered by the state to offset
right.
that. Okay. Claire,
nice article in the paper. You did a good job of explaining the
propositions and the optional tax vote that we hope the rural residents will support since they're already paying it.
That's right. You know, Judge, and that's the important point of that, and she did pick that up in the article. A lot of that is already being charged. I don't know what the percentage is, but there's a significant amount of it already being paid by the consumer.
I thought the same thing, and Judge Good point to make. Claire, thank you.
That's the key to that whole deal.
Paying attention to that was the paramount.
There is a good percentage of it already being collected.
Hopefully people will
realize that, but only the rural voter gets to, so there's about 6,000 possible votes out there. Few people that actually show realize they're not increasing the taxes on themselves. They're, as Commissioner Harvey said, we're bringing that money back home instead of giving it to us.
It's less about collection and more about recovering, really.
The collection's happening.
Collection's happening.
All right. Anything else?
Judge, on a sidebar note, I appreciate what the court's trying to do this morning on health insurance.
Well, we're sure looking at it.
It's turned into a very big Rubik's Cube, and I can assure you I attended the budget meeting for the city of Wichita Falls. Our friends up the hill here, back to the west, they've got some of the same struggles. And like Barry said, it's not going away.
Yeah.
No.
It could really eat us in the next few years if we're not on top of it.
I wouldn't paraphrase Mayor Marv. He said right there when the budget was passed, the next 10 years, municipal government. Health insurance may not exist. You give your employees a stipend and let them explore the free market and go that route and just go ahead and pay your fine to the federal government if you have to, and you're still money ahead at the end of the calendar year. That's sad.
It's being done in the private sector just like that.
I'm going to tell you right now, Commissioner Mahler, I've got citizens in our lobby that tell us every day that they take full advantage of the services at community health care. That's on a sliding scale. Mm-hmm. And then pay the fine at the end of the year, and they're money ahead.
Yeah.
It's a sad day when your family coverage is twice what your house payment is. And there's people that are employed in this county that don't make as much as family coverage is. And that's a sad day.
Now, you know, for him to sit here and say what he said on mine, that Wichita Falls is one of the highest in the country.
Shocking.
About setting you back. Prescription drug going up next year 12%.
Sure could. Well, and we saw in the bids on jail health care.
Same thing.
Mm-hmm. And the big chunk of that is mental health coverage. Yeah. You know, and
holding $300,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. To look at doing that because the state has reduced the number of mental health beds.
They're going out of the business, basically.
While we're one of the fastest growing states, we're not getting all good people. We're getting some others in there that are adding to the burden of cost. All right, it's 11:23 and we're adjourned.
How many of you want to go to Republican Women's for lunch?
Yeah.